All right. I'm going to go ahead and call this board meeting to order of the Santa Barbara City College Board of Trustees for Thursday, August 18th, 2022. And we are going to begin with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Great, and I will note that all board members are present, either physically or digitally. We have all of our trustees, including our student trustee here today. And Trustee Gallardo is joining us digitally. So she is on the Zoom call, and I am monitoring that for raised hands and for members of the public that may be wanting to join in. So welcome, and we're going to move forward to item 2.5, which is longevity recognition. I am just going to note that we have a big party every spring for our employees who've been with us for quite a number of years. And we have a list here today. So I'm gonna go ahead and read these employees off. We have Fabiola Hernandez, who has been with us for 15 years as a teacher in the preschool. We have Nancy Keller, who's been here for 20 years as an admissions and records technician. Brian Marino, who's been here 10 years as an administrative assistant. Dean Nevins, who's been here 25 years. Getting special claps because he is currently in the room right now and currently the executive director of IT. We have Pablo Ochoa, 10 years, who is a bookstore assistant. Elizabeth Rizzo, 15 years as a director of one of our children's centers. James Watson, laboratory teaching assistant, 15 years. And Roberta Yescas, an accounting technician, 15 years at SBCC. The total number of years of service is 125 for this particular group. So I hope the party for you guys is particularly awesome. That brings us to item 2.6, items to be taken out of order. And I don't think we have anything today. That's correct. Okay. At this time, we are going to move into closed session. In closed session, we are going to be talking about items 3.3, employee discipline dismissal release, 3.4, conference with labor negotiator faculty association, and 3.5, conference with labor negotiator California School Employee Association. I don't believe we have any public comment on those three exact items. We will take public comment on our public agenda when we return. We're going to go into closed session. Time certain, we will return at 5 p.m. So at this point, I'm going to adjourn the open session and move us into closed session. Thank you. to our open session, where we will continue along with our agenda. I have nothing to report out of closed session. So first on our list is item 5.1, public comment. And I'm opening emails and getting all this. Here we go. Okay, so I think at this time, we have two public comments via Zoom. Is that correct? And one in person? Great. So let's go ahead and we will start with our Zoom speakers. I'd like to see if we could go ahead and pull them both in so that one can go immediately after the other. They're going to have 5 minutes to speak for public comment. First up is going to be Maria Kessner. And after her, we'll have Catherine Lee. And I see Dr. Smith, I see your hand raised as well. So it's fine to go ahead and after Maria is finished, if you want to pull in Dr. Amy Smith for public comment, that would be great too, Lou. Are we having trouble getting Ms. Kessner in? Not accepting? All right. Ms. Kessner, I can see, is she coming in now? I can see her as a guest. Ms. Kessner, we're trying to get you in. Oh, there, yay, you came in. All right, so Ms. Kessner, if you want to start, followed by Catherine Lee.
Hello, dear Board of Trustees. I think we're coming back and circling back to the same issue here again. You are continuing your COVID policies at SBCC, and you continue to coerce your students into vaccinations that, to my knowledge, are still under EUA status because our official trials run till December 2022, January 2023. And those are violations of the law. For example, they're a violation of the Bain Act. You cannot in the state of California coerce anybody into anything that they are legally protected from. And so you received a letter from Assembly Committee on Higher Education member, and it's Republican Kevin Kiley, and he wrote you a letter basically telling you that the CDC does not distinguish anymore between people that are vaccinated and that are not vaccinated in their COVID-19 policies, and that your policies continue to be discriminatory, which is yet another violation in California under the UNRU Act. There are federal laws too that are applicable, but I'm just now talking about the state of California. And so, it seems like the Board of Trustees of this particular institution continues to implement policies that are not only unlawful, but they're also unscientific. And one of the top experts in the nation on PPE and also on masks and mask wearing has pointed out that masks are not even PPE. They're not even considered PPE. And Stephen Petty is the top expert in the nation. He's been cited in over 400 legal cases because there are a lot of people around the country that are suing their local governments for violating their civil rights and their, forcing them to taking these products. And so, you know, it's just, I don't know what to say. I am just stunned that my tax dollars continue to go to your institution. I would like to also point out that this is a total power grab at a federal government, because basically the federal government is just funding all these institutions and flooding local governments with federal money. And in exchange, they get compliant board members and people, local representatives in government, to do exactly what the federal government wants them to do. And at this point, I think the public needs to get their act together. They need to realize they have rights. They need to realize that the government is usually the biggest violator of the rule of law. And myself, this has nothing to do with SBCC, but I just filed a lawsuit against Santa Barbara MTD. It's filed, they haven't been served yet, but I'm gonna stand on my rights. I hope people get together and people that feel discriminated against and coerced into these discriminatory policies and these unlawful products, being coerced into these unlawful products, that they get together and there be some class action lawsuits. Because your policies are just absolutely outrageous. It is unscientific. It makes no sense. Young people are not the ones that are at risk. If you are a person that is teaching and is at risk, then you take a step back. Then you go and teach from Zoom. Let your students show up in class. Let them decide which they have a legal right to, if they want to get vaccinated or mask or whatever. Masks don't work because COVID is spread via aerosols, and masks don't work for aerosols. And that's a scientific fact. You're supposed to be a higher institution that is supposed to educate our youth. And basically you're expecting them to be sheep and allow for your policies, your unlawful policies, to be forced onto the public. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ms. Kessner, now we're going to have Catherine Lape, and if we could go ahead and bring Amy Smith into the Zoom.
Good afternoon. This is Catherine Lape. I just want to start off by saying that I appreciate so much being able to.
Can you pause just for one moment, Ms. Lape, because it's a little bit, you're very soft spoken here. I'm not sure if we can up the mic level. We're having our tech take a look at that.
Hello? Can you hear me better? Sorry.
A little bit better? Yeah, that's definitely better.
Okay. I had headphones on. Thank you for that. So first of all, I just wanted to let you guys know that City College for me is like such a fertile ground for basically my life, but you know, all of my endeavors that I'm working on right now. And I know everybody's been really hard to keep everything going during all these pandemic times. So I really appreciate the teachers and everything that have been keeping things going. So I wanted to share with you an experience I had this summer. I was in an environmental horticulture class, and on the last day, we had about 20 students in the class. It was a hybrid class. And I just have to tell you, the feeling in the room was just palpable of how grateful these students were to be together in this classroom. And it just struck me so much how important that was to everyone, because I'd been on campus all year, coming 3 to 5 times a week, and I forget that there's so many students that are not able to have that experience, and just how much more effective the learning and education is. And especially as we're looking at students coming out of high school, for the last 2 years for them have just been completely, their learning situation completely compromised. And it was my sincere hope that we would be able to get them back on campus. Looking at the numbers from last year, I don't have the numbers from this year, but 2 out of 5 students were not able to enroll in in-person classes. And we're still, you know, I don't have the numbers for this year, but I think we should do whatever it takes to get those people back on campus. It's a public institution. And, you know, that's a large number. That was 6,000 that were not able to join us on campus, but I can give you some people that I knew that were not there. You know, combat veteran was not there. Students that had seen severe vaccine injuries and knew that they were not at risk because they'd had COVID and made the decision that they didn't want to take the risk of a vaccine were not there. I know we've all been affected by this severe trauma and pain of losing people and, you know, just so much going on, but I really feel like the best thing for the community to bring everybody back together and healing is to allow these students to come back to school. And it's such a formative time in their life. I'm around these people and just watching them learn and seeing how the teachers interact with them in person. It's like watching flowers open up. It's so beautiful. And I really ask that looking at where we are now with the changes in the pandemic becoming endemic and all of the changes in the recommendations, including that, you know, unvaccinated are no longer to be treated differently than vaccinated anymore, because as you know, looking at all the figures, vaccinated also catch spread the disease, and that a lot of people have natural immunity. And so they are not, you know, at risk for severe disease anymore, just like vaccinated, hopefully. And so I just really call on you, Board of Trustees, to make this happen before fall season starts. The way that you can do that is to call a special meeting. Four of you need to email Dr. Kindred, ask for a special meeting before school starts August 30th, and vote this thing out, vote the mandate out so that these students can come back to school. The barriers that we are putting our students under are not like little pony walls to walk over. They are insurmountable barriers. I talk to students coming from Ivy. They don't have time on their day off to take the bus down to City College to get a test when tests are not even, asymptomatic screening is no longer recommended by the CDC. So you're asking these students, you know, that are really, really need this to do things that are not helping anyone at all. You're continuing this policy, and I'm asking you to please not wait until September 15th to look at resolution and get this done so these students can rematriculate and we can start to heal from this pandemic together as a community. It's so important, and you know that you can do this. So I ask you to please do this. It's such a small thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Lee. Dr. Amy Smith.
Hello, how are you tonight? I'm along the same lines as the last two speakers. The CDC no longer advises different behavior for those who've received the genetic engineered mRNA and or DNA COVID interventions from those who haven't. These products were never claimed to stop transmission. They were only to reduce symptoms. So the science has always been dubious to mandate them. People's personal choice of what to do with their personal risk should have remained a personal choice. The claim of a pandemic of the unvaccinated was based on flawed field data. And as people continue to pore over the released documents of the original studies, we find evidence that throws into question the safety, especially for young people, and efficacy of these interventions. Turns out that many hospital patients who also had COVID, even if they were in the hospital for a gunshot wound or broken ankle, were deemed unvaccinated if their vaccination status was listed as unknown. Typically, this was the listing if they were vaccinated somewhere outside of the health system of that particular hospital. This created a mischaracterization of many fully vaccinated patients declared to be COVID patients as unvaccinated. This inaccurate data was then used to feed the unproven claim of a pandemic of the unvaccinated. This is why it is not reliable to draw conclusions from field data. This is why long-term studies with honest monitoring of negative effects is necessary. Unfortunately, it has been known for some time that the profit incentive makes it difficult to get honest data out of pharmaceutical trials. Fraud has been uncovered in many cases. Spin is routine. And researchers who did Freedom of Information Act requests to examine the study data have found these novel technology injections to be no exception. For example, it seems that 44% of the women who were pregnant during the study had miscarriages. One of the children who participated in the trials, Maddie DeGarry, experienced permanent debilitating injury, and yet her reaction was not accurately recorded. What else is hidden? Are you looking into it? The viral variant of SARS-CoV-2 that these so-labeled vaccine interventions were designed to give protection to was the Wuhan strain. We have now gone through Delta and Alpha are in Omicron, and the efficacy of these mandated products for these later strains has not been proven. And despite the data bias errors in counting a large percentage of vaccinated people as unvaccinated in hospitals, the rate of hospitalization and deaths of the fully vaccinated and boosted has been outstripping the rate of the unvaccinated. Health officials such as our own county stopped reporting the differentiated data. It seems quite likely that they stopped giving us this information once it started to raise doubts about the effectiveness of these products. In many ways, it feels like the CDC, the California Department of Public Health, and our County Office of Public Health have acted as marketeers for these profitable liability protector products rather than focus on what is the best information to help members of the public protect themselves and their families. Vitamin D has been proven now to be effective against preventing severe COVID. Low vitamin D status was known to be a risk factor, yet why was this information not trumpeted from the rooftops? Well, the County Board of Supervisors never imposed a mandate, but they did require vaccination or regular testing of all county employees. In light of the evolution of SARS-CoV-2, they have dropped those requirements. Allen Hancock Community College dropped their mandate last spring. Ventura Community College dropped theirs earlier this month. Students who have felt alienated by these policies that were never based in science need to be included in the SBCC community. The manufacturers never claim these vaccines drop transmission. All they could do was reduce symptoms. This is a personal choice and not something that should not be coerced. The licensed form of the Pfizer vaccine is still not available in the US, only the emergency use authorization version. Perhaps that explains why President Biden just extended the COVID emergency. Without the COVID emergency, these shots can no longer be protected from liability. These COVID shots have the most adverse reactions of all prior vaccines combined since the VAERS system began taking reports, I think in 1990. VAERS is the safety system that the government put in place to track problems with vaccines, yet government and regulatory officials are not examining that data and addressing these problems. Why? Many fear is because the pharmaceutical industry has captured the officials and regulatory bodies. There are direct financial conflicts of interest that are tolerated with people who approve these products and make guidance. Even the CDC director is aware that they have lost the trust of much of the American public. Only around 5% of parents took the advice to get their youngest children vaccinated. The emergency is over. Now, thankfully, the risks of COVID are much less. You did your best in a confusing time. You mandated something that you thought would protect. The full story was not honestly presented. The media and elected officials and public health authorities made mistakes.
Thank you so much. We appreciate your public comment.
And do the right thing and drop the mandate. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We do have one in-person public comment from Lisa Ostendorf. Are you Lisa Ostendorf? So I see that you are out in the hallway, probably because it's open to the outside. Would you like to speak out there with the mic? Okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's what we told her she could.
Thank you.
I'm Lisa Ostendorf, and I'm a former Santa Barbara City College student. I have not been able to finish my degree or go to any SBCC affiliated functions for 2.5 years due to lockdowns, subpar online teaching, and then medical mandates. There are many, many people who, like me, have been forced off campus.
There are many, many people who, like me, have been forced off campus, and that does not align with your policies of equity and inclusion. There is a large percentage of Hispanic students who have stopped attending. And there's no way to accommodate them without dropping your mandates. Some of us have medical directives from our doctors that say any injections, testing, or masking is more dangerous to our health than following the SBCC mandates. There is no way for SBCC to accommodate this group of people without dropping your mandates. I know the board cares about having SBCC accessible to everyone and to have a flourishing campus, as in before COVID. Please consider that your COVID policies must be dropped in order to accomplish your greater goals. We want SBCC to again be an example of one of the best community colleges in the nation, and one that respects the needs and rights of all of its students and the entire community. Thank you.
Thank you so much, and thanks for your flexibility out there. That brings us to the end of public comment. And with that, let me get myself back to the board agenda. We are going to move to item 6.1, approval of minutes. These were the minutes for May 19th, 2022. Is there a motion to approve?
So moved.
And is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Trustee Hasland. And we will do a roll call vote.
Student Trustee Raja Osera.
Aye.
Trustee Nahr.
Aye.
Trustee Hasland.
Aye.
Trustee Gallardo.
Yes.
Trustee Parker.
Aye.
Trustee Abu.
Yes.
Trustee Croninger.
Yes.
And Trustee Ever.
Aye.
All right. Item 6.1, the approval of minutes, passes unanimously. This brings us to communications. I think we're going to start with item 7.2, a report from the Academic Senate. Is that correct?
Yes, and I don't see Melanie in the... I don't see her in the participation. I think she was going to do it by Zoom, but I am not seeing her. So can we call her up if she comes in before we finish?
Yes, absolutely. Oh, it says she's an attendee. So maybe we can pull her in from... We're having technical conferring going on. I see her there, yeah. She's in the attendees, so if we can pull her in as a panelist.
Yeah, there she is.
Hold on a moment. Will you unmute yourself? Oh dear. Well, we cannot hear. So let's give SBCC IT a moment to figure out what's going on there. Okay. So, what's going on with the microphone on your end, Dr. Eckford Prosser? Because we cannot hear you. Can you change your audio output, your microphone input? When you hit that up arrow is next to select a microphone. Is it on your laptop? All right. My suggestion, Dr. Eckford Prosser, is that we move on and that we maybe have IT connect with you separately and see what they can perhaps talk you through, and we will always circle back to you, okay? Thank you. Good thing for that thumbs up. We appreciate that. That brings us to item 7.3, the report from Associated Student Government, Turner Diallo.
Good evening, everyone. I want to further congratulate Fabi and all of the longevity employees for all of your dedications in support of student success you have my full gratitude. And today I'll be reporting on what the ASG have been doing for the past few weeks or months since we closed for last semester. And one of the main things we have really been focusing on is to get a head start into the fourth semester. And we have done that by launching the application for commissioners so that we can have more student leaders join us in representing and advocating for the students' body. And the application was launched on July 28th, and the deadline will be on September 9th. So I would like to encourage all of the students in our community to take advantage of this opportunity to be part of the decision-making process and create a better and memorable experience for every student. So please look out for the application and make sure to join the ASG for the next year. And the next thing is we also want to put much more effort into encouraging everyone in the community, not only the students, but every community member to support and attend like the athletic games. Now, since the COVID-19, these athletes have been going through it all, but they never give up. They went and played games even without, you know, cheering or supporters. But now that we are coming back to a much more normal society, it would be very great to attend those games and cheer our athletes, you know, to give them the courage and motivation to keep pushing forward. And because everything that they do is for the success and accomplishment of Santa Barbara City College and the community. So the ASG is going to do its part by attending some or most of the games of every athletic club, starting from the fourth semester. And we'll make sure to create some engaging activities, like pre-game activities and halftime shows for those athletic clubs so that students can feel more encouraged to support their teams. And lastly, regarding the COVID mandate, I think it's clear that there's a lot of people in the community who have mixed feelings about this. Some people think they are more at risk in observing COVID mandates or rules, and others have like opposite feeling that they feel safer with, you know, going by medical procedures. So what the ASG can do, because we are not medical experts, is to encourage the Board of Trustees and the authority to speedily look into this, into the recommendation of the public before the opening of the school, so that we can ensure, you know, accommodate all of our students in the community by studying the barriers that are stopping students from attending the campus, that is both the COVID mandate and other barriers that may exist, to study this fully and in a speedy manner so that it can all be addressed, so we can be able to equitably accommodate every student in the community and make sure everyone have the right access to education that they deserve. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Are we ready to try Dr. Eckford Prosser yet? All right, we have a hopeful thumbs up from IT. So let's see if we can circle back to the previous item and hear from the Faculty Senate.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes.
The Verizon commercial. And then also, do you want to hear from the Faculty Senate? I'm going with yes, but
we do.
Hopeful, shall we? All right. So it's Melanie Eckford Prosser here. I just wanted to give you guys a few quick highlights about the Senate and the faculty. I'm really looking forward to the Academic Senate retreat on 8/24. I think we're going to the zoo, which will be great. To our in-service day as a campus on 8/25 and 8/26. And I have some information about what we've been doing as a faculty, but I wanted to start by raising two concerns of faculty. First is the flexibility in filling face-to-face classes. Our new VPAA, Maria Villa Gomez, has been really helpful and has crafted a document that really allows departments to pedagogically support faculty so that we can meet students and SBCC employees where they are. This flexibility is key, and it can help us keep our word to our students and to our faculty about the modality of their classes. It's not a complete panacea, but I think it's a great start. And so I thank the VPAA, the deans, and the department chairs for working on this. Second, safety. Faculty have mixed opinions about masking, and the changes to the kinds of masks required has left some faculty feeling upset and unsupported. The virus continues, and many worry about long COVID. On the other hand, some faculty are less concerned, making this a really complex time. I've been in some meetings where people have come up with helpful, creative ways to respond to faculty concerns about safety. And so from both of those, I guess my key message here is clarity of message and a very consistent, proactive, early communication to faculty and students. The earlier we can give people a heads up, I think the better. I want to segue from that to a general appreciation for how hard everyone, staff, managers, department chairs, deans, and so on, are working as we continue to adapt to the changes in tiers and the effects on the return to campus. And I want to highlight something right here, which is the ALLY. And it's the Effective Learning Institute. It's a homegrown, data-driven SBCC initiative, which encourages faculty to rethink the ways we teach, how we create syllabi, how we assess our students, how we think about neuroplasticity of the brain, how we bring those all to our students to improve their experience and to improve our teaching. About 20 faculty and counselors, faculty both full-time and adjunct, are attending. And I just wanted to give a shout out to the team of dedicated faculty who are running that. Leda Tolentino, Josh Ramirez, Tara Carter, Tomas Carrasco, Justina Buller, as well as Dean Elizabeth Imhoff. It is a really, really impressive thing. I think I went to the first one. I've been to some through the years. They always adapt and change. So I think that speaks to the kind of faculty that we have. I want to also highlight Emma, which is the Enrollment Management Academy. I went there along with a diverse team from SBCC, including VPs and deans and managers and faculty. And the material went substantially beyond providing only target numbers for enrollment. Your class needs to have this many students. It taught us how to calculate those figures, as well as making it clear how to manage those numbers. And I'm an English professor. And I'm not anti-number. In fact, I was a math major when I began as an undergraduate. But for the first time ever, I truly understood how and why the school functions the way it functions, the consequences of enrollment beyond the really obvious simplistic way. And so we talked to the group that was there. The Emma people are coming to our campus, which is really wonderful. Thank you, Dr. Murillo, for making that happen. And the department chairs are going to get to see this. And I'm very excited about that. They might not be because the trainings are long, but I think at the end of it, they will see the worth of it. And I think really what it goes to is a democratizing of the way we understand the enrollment of the institution. I think the more people understand, the better, and the more the faculty understand, the better. So I'm really excited about that. And here's the last point. At the Emma, I got to meet and spend some time with our new VPs, our VPAA of Academic Affairs, Maria Villa Gomez, and our VP of Student Affairs, Paloma Arnold. And I think that breaking the EVP role into those two VP roles was a great idea. And I wanted to thank Dr. Murillo and the board for supporting that. I think we have excellent candidates. I'm really excited to see what they do to help reshape SBCC. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Lovely to get the update from the Faculty Senate. Busy, busy times ahead. Moving forward is 7.4, report from classified employees, Liz Auchincloss, who needs to be pulled in as a panelist.
I'm in, thanks.
There you are. You're fast.
Oh, it was Luke that was fast.
Okay.
Good afternoon, President Parker, members of the board. Staff, as they always do this time of the year, are getting ready for school to start. Most of them work through summer one and two, so now they're getting ready to start for the fall. And I think a lot of people are looking forward to the in-service next week. They're also have a lot of concerns or just uncertainty of the COVID protocols that are going to take effect for fall. So I think there's a meeting soon to discuss, especially the student services folks. Kind of want to know what's going to happen, so we're waiting for that. I want to acknowledge that staff have been having opportunities to do anti-bias training. I have one scheduled for tomorrow, and a lot of people are being involved in that, so I appreciate the district providing that. And the other thing, we're, as you know, we're in negotiations. We've been doing, I think we're making some good progress with negotiations. The only issue is that we're losing Michael Shanahan. And I just wanted to express appreciation to Michael for the years that he spent here. He's been very good to work with. We haven't always agreed on things, but we've been able to be respectfully disagreement. And we've usually been able to work out a compromise one way or another. So I want to thank Michael for his service. Wish it were longer, but I can appreciate that he wants to retire and move on with his life. But hopefully we'll get as close to finishing up our negotiations as we can before he leaves us. But I just wanted to express appreciation for him because he knows his stuff and he's been very helpful and he's been respectful to our unit. So I want to thank him for that. And I think that's the end of my report. Thanks.
All right, thank you so much, Ms. Auchincloss. And thanks to the CSEA and our classified staff for everything they do. Next up is 7.5, report from the Faculty Association, Dr. Cornelia Alzheimer-Bertel.
Hello, everyone. Could I please have my slides? That would be great, thank you. Honorable members of the Board of Trustees, President Parker, Dr. Murillo, good afternoon.
And I just want to note, it is a little bit difficult to hear some of the speakers with the masks right up. So if you want to like loosen or get the mic right up next to you, whatever works
can
for
I
you.
Can I take it off?
If you want to pull it up the mic,
that
yeah.
That would be great. Thank you. So thank you for that. And thank you for having the Faculty Association on your agenda again today. And thank you for having this meeting on campus. It feels good to be back in person, and to make it even feel better, the FA is sponsoring coffee and chocolate for everyone, so please feel free to help yourself. Next slide, please. And here are my topics for today's report. I would like to provide a brief recap of the FA retreat, then share with you an update on our current contract negotiations, as well as the many other activities that the FA has been and will continue to be engaged in over the summer. And finally, an outlook of what is coming up in early fall. Next slide, please. Our FA retreat was very successful. I want to thank the PE department again for hosting us in their tent and helping us out with tables and chairs, and most importantly, with a coffee maker. And thank you also goes out to our IT department who set us up with a screen and other technology. We had all 11 FA board members attending the retreat. on the topics covered. One of the long-range projects of the Faculty Association has been the revision of our 50-page faculty evaluation policy, a six-person work group with three FA board members and three additional faculty from key areas had spent many hours on this project, and this was the first time that the whole FA board looked at this work. Together, we identified a few more areas where we can make even more improvements before we will bring this to the Academic Senate for consultation this fall, and thereafter, we will bring it forward in negotiations. Next, we immersed ourselves into the budget. Specifically, we looked at a first sneak preview at the updated actuals for last year, the budget for this year, and the projections for the next 5 years, which our amazing fiscal team under the leadership of Lindsay Mass and Rudy Hill had shared with us. So our thanks goes out to them as well. The FA was very happy that what we were looking at is generally good news for the college, and we are looking forward to the upcoming budget presentations and discussions with the board and CPC once we have the most updated numbers. A big part of our discussion was also devoted to coming back to campus this fall and to do so safely for our faculty and students. And please allow me to point out that every single one of our FA board members has on-campus in-person assignments this fall. Most of us were already back in person for the last year. So we are not only talking the talk, we are also walking the walk. During the last part of our retreat, we were able to welcome trustees Marsha Croninger and Robert Miller. They had come to listen to the FA and also to share their personal views on the college's fiscal health. We looked at the preliminary five-year budget together. We also reviewed our student enrollment and the numbers of our various employee groups over the last 5 years. The FA repeated our concern that we have seen a declining number of students, together with a dramatic decrease in full-time faculty, while the number of managers has been increasing, and how each of these impacts our budget. The FA wants to express our appreciation to Trustees Miller and Croninger for taking the time to meet with us and for the productive exchange of ideas and observation. Next slide, please. As always, there is news to report from negotiations. The district and FA teams have been focusing most recently on two items: the safe return to campus this fall and the increased workload for our department chairs, with special focus on efforts related to build up our enrollment and our on-campus presence. In addition, part-time faculty health insurance will become a significant part of our negotiations once the Chancellor's Office actually comes up with their plan on how to allocate the $200 million that the governor had put into his budget. This money is ongoing, and the FA would like to use whatever the SBCC share will be as quickly as possible to improve our health insurance offer for part-time faculty. We want our current plan to be more affordable and more accessible for our part-time colleagues. And there's even another aspect why part-time faculty health insurance has come into the focus. The college is expecting this year almost $7 million one-time money from the COVID-19 recovery block grant. And as a condition of receiving these funds, college districts are required to report to the Chancellor's Office metrics on their employer-sponsored health insurance for part-time faculty by March 1st. Continuing on the topic of funds that the college will receive, while COLA negotiations for the past year were concluded not too long ago, time flies by. So the FA will present the district with our proposal for the current year shortly. Please stay tuned. Next slide, please. Here you can see my A to Z list again of association summer work. It is very similar to the July one. The FA continued a lot of activities during that last month of summer break in order to support our college community in various roles and various ways. Again, I would like to point out a few things. Our faculty, and I would like to highlight our English department and the leadership of Jody Millward on this, is still putting a lot of effort into educating our legislators on the damage that AB 1705 will do if it is not amended. It would take choices away from our students. This is unacceptable. And if you want to join us faculty in this effort and need more information, please do not hesitate to let us know and we can join forces. For the FA leadership, I would like to highlight that our association board members are not only great labor representatives, but also engaged teachers. Some of us are currently participating in the 3-day Effective Learning Institute that Dr. Eckford Prosser previously referenced. We want to enhance what we do in the classroom and in our educational support work. I also want to point out that the FA, together with the other constituent group leaders, was instrumental in preparing for the last CPC retreat. Please let me know if you have any questions on any of the other items on this list, but for now, I would like to jump ahead what's coming up next week. Next slide, please. The FA will participate in the new full-time faculty orientation, as well as the faculty in service, which will both happen next week. And in our first regular FA board meeting on September 2nd, the FA will elect our 2022-23 association officers. And for sure, the FA president will attend your board retreat in 2 days. So I'm looking forward to seeing you all again soon. Next slide, please. Thank you so much for your attention and feel free to ask any questions you might have.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alzheimer-Bartel. What a summer. Like, was there summer? Did that happen? Thank you. Great to get the update. And clearly, you are all very, very busy. Report from Board Subcommittee 7.6. I do not believe any of the subcommittees have met, so I'm going to jump ahead to 7.7, the report. Oh, apparently I lied. Tell me about it.
So we've had a lot of policy committee. There's three that we want to look out for coming up, which is one for our superintendent hiring, one for our diversity, and then the last one, I lost my note there, is the infectious disease. That's the big one, the full resolution one. So we reviewed all of those and even more. We had 11 policies on our agenda, so we're going through it.
All right, great. Good to hear. Thank you. Now we are ready for 7.7, the report from Interim Superintendent President, Dr. Maria.
Thank you. And just to build on that, we will have a Finance Committee meeting next week, and that agenda will be posted tomorrow with the final budget draft and the 5-year projections and a couple of more items. And then on Wednesday, we have the Policy Committee meeting where we will address the policies that Vice President Abood noted. One of the things that's going to be really important is to do the updates for the president hiring so that we can keep you on time to get you hopefully into a new president hiring process early next year. So we will review the timeline at your retreat next week. The real importance of the infectious disease policy and procedure will be around on the September meeting. We are going to ask the board to accept the policy recommendation from the committee to implement a policy and procedure and rescind resolution number one, which is kind of antiquated at this moment. And I'm finding myself having to use my powers more regularly than I'd like to. So I think it's time to let that one go. So the plan is that we will do a survey when school starts of students and our faculty and staff regarding vaccination requirements, masking requirements, and how people feel about all of this. We will also come to the board on September 15th with what I just told you, the two policy, the policy and procedure, and a request to rescind resolution one. And we did actually schedule classes with a masking mandate in place. And we intend to keep that masking mandate at this point in time because faculty took classes with that mandate and our students did enroll. We will look at the vaccination requirement this fall. And we will only ask that we keep our current requirement to December 31st. We think at this point in time, the current resolution one is outdated and the efficacy of the way our vaccine mandate reads is really not doing anything for us. So we think we really have to seriously look at this as an institution. So pretty much the protocols that we've been putting out in our emails every week almost, when we change from medium to high, are in place. We don't plan on changing them, and we don't expect that we're going to go into low anytime soon, which would we would go away from the masking mandate. So that's the plan at the moment. We've been working with our unions to make sure that the employees are honored in the way that we told them we would when we scheduled the fall schedules. We would like to put in new protocols that align more with the county for our spring enrollment, and that is our plan. So at this point, that's where we are. So pretty much we're masking. We dropped the N95, KN95 masking requirement because we felt it was too onerous for many people and we were having a lot of issues with it. So at this point in medium tier and high tier, we adhere to a masking mandate inside our buildings. And so that's kind of where we're at the moment. As our guest here has noted, we're living in this land, and our Turner, Dallo noted, we live in this land of nobody's happy with us. And we would like to recommend to the board that we move toward aligning to the county's guidelines. And so we also want to make sure that our employees and our faculty and staff have some level of feeling like they are, that we're backing them with what we said we would do. So that's where we live. And so that's where we're at. Not everybody's mad at us. So that's, you know, I apologize to everybody. It's really hard, but we're trying to honor our students, our community, and our employees and our faculty who are in the classroom. And I want to say to the board, I am proud of our faculty because they actually put up 800 sections for fall. That was that face-to-face on campuses. And I think that's amazing. So I can tell you that I think we're better than any of the other colleges I've been talking to about our faculty teaching in person. So pretty excited about that. And we're going to keep driving toward meeting the county guidelines. So, all right, any questions? Oh, one last thing. I want to congratulate Vice President Shanahan on his retirement and thank him for his service. Although I think he will be at the next meeting, hopefully.
And I hope so too. So I want to be cautious about questions here because we are not agendized to talk about COVID requirements. And so this is an update from the superintendent. You're welcome to make a brief comment, but we're not going to go into any discussion right now on, not going to raise any questions about it. It's going to come back to us September 15th. We will have a lot to say at that meeting, but if you have some brief feedback you would like to give to Dr. Murillo at this time, you are welcome to do that. Trustee Haslund?
I would like to just ask about the the survey that is going to be conducted, it's going to affect all of the faculty who are coming on campus, or all faculty, period?
All faculty. It'll be everybody, and it will be all students. So it's going to be a simple survey, because we learned that if you do a long survey, people will not take it. So we're going to make it very clean and very to the point, and we're going to try to get it out very early in the semester.
And the results will be immediately available?
And we hope to have the results by the time we get to September 15th.
Good. And just a point of clarification, I took my mask off when speaking. I think that's okay, as it is for the person behind the microphone.
I know that it's really difficult to hear with the mask on, and I appreciate that sometimes we need to make some adjustments because of that. Trustee Everett?
I just wanted to say, in reference to the president's comment about everybody being upset with her and the campus, I appreciated the forum that we had, and I wanted to say that even though we had many people disagreeing with us, I really appreciate how respectful and how thoughtful they were in voicing their differences with us. And I've just been, you know, proud of that, because watching all the coverage across the country, I feel that we have a really respectful community here that understands that you can express disagreements and be passionate without being uncivil. So I just wanted to acknowledge that.
Thank you. Trustee Gallardo.
Thank you, Kate. I echo with what Anna just said. I think there's a lot of lovely people that are passionate of our mission and are being wonderful. Kindred, I just want to make sure I understand, because, you know, I forward you emails, and then, and you being very gracious to talk to parents. So for students that wish to enroll at Santa Barbara City College this fall, they will have to either get an exemption. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then if they get an exemption, they'll just wear whatever mask is available in their home or they purchase elsewhere. Is that correct?
Yes, we are requiring masks, yes.
Okay, so just any mask. And so for the spring semester, so for fall, it would have to be either get the exemption or stay online.
Or upload your vaccine card, which most students have been doing, so yes.
Right, for the, but these are for the families where the vaccine is not an option at this time yet, and they have not made that decision with their doctors. So, and the reason I'm asking is because, and we previously talked about, we reached out to Alan Hancock for them to come into our district to offer the services to the students that are not being offered to them through our college. So for dual enrollment students at the high school, that doesn't affect them, correct? Because they're at the high school and they follow the guidelines of the high school.
That is correct.
Okay, so that's good. Okay, so then that clarifies that. I think that that gives parents options and choices, and then we can further our conversations with Ellen Hancock College. Thank you.
All right. This moves us down to item 8, the development of the consent agenda. So the consent agenda tonight consists of all items on in sections 9, human resources, 10, academic affairs, 11, student affairs, which we have nothing in, and then 12, business services. Does anybody have any item that needs to be pulled? Seeing no items that need to be pulled, is there a motion to pass the consent agenda?
So moved.
Could you identify the numbers of the consent agenda, 9 through?
It's 9, 10, 11, and 12 through all of those.
I'll second the motion.
All right. Moved by Trustee Miller, seconded by Trustee Hasland, and we will take a roll call vote.
Kate, you probably can't see my hand.
I missed your hand before. Did you have one that you wanted to pull?
Right? No, I don't need to pull it. But now that there's a first and a second, I just had a question if there is a discussion.
All right. Which one did you want to have a quick question on?
12.2 Kindred, we approved this one before, so this is probably like the second round. And I've read through the website. This is now the second time. It's hard to visualize what exactly the service is. There's a lot of about healing and different things. I looked through the bios for the different folks, and there are a couple people that have like the licensed social workers or the MFT. Can you tell us more? As I understand it, this is a service being provided to the employees, and it's to address some type of mental health issue.
No, we're not trying to provide mental health services to our employees through this. This is a trauma-informed racial healing process to help give people the tools around emotional intelligence and social awareness and cultural intelligence to be able to work with people that have been traumatized either by racial issues or gender issues, or but generally this was developed around racial trauma. And so it's about giving tools to people to help them really have that the awareness of those around us who have been traumatized and how to work with them. And this is not a required training. This is being funded by Title III, and it's being offered in groups. You can opt in, you can opt out. And what we heard last year when we were doing a lot of listening as members of the cabinet and those of us who sat and talked with a lot of employees, we need to do some really good work with providing people tools. And Lumos Transformed was actually piloted by our ally team this summer. And there wasn't one employee that I heard from that went to it that didn't come back and just go, we need this. And so I enthusiastically endorse this. I'm going to sign up immediately.
Awesome. Thank you for that explanation. And this was, through Elizabeth's work and research?
Yes. Actually, the person who did the research on this was Justina Bueller. And she did the original research on this project. And then the Title III grant is with Elizabeth. So, and Elizabeth and I have been working quite a bit this summer to see if we could actually use the Title III to provide this service to all of our employees.
Awesome. Okay, thank you.
All right. Thank you. And now I think we're ready for the roll call vote.
Student Trustee Raja Osera.
Hi.
Trustee Gallardo?
Yes.
Trustee Abood?
Yes.
Trustee Cloninger?
Yes.
Trustee Parker?
Aye.
Trustee Haslund?
Aye.
Trustee Everett?
Aye.
Trustee Miller?
Aye.
Right, that consent agenda passes unanimously. That brings us to item 13.1, classification. Do we have anything in 13.1?
There should be. I'm seeing, I put it in there. It originally showed up wrong. It was in the administrative content.
I think I need to refresh my page.
Okay, because I moved it. Trustee Cloninger caught it the other day, and so I moved it into the public. So it's regarding two classifications for our laboratory teaching assistant. We're requesting the board approval.
Is there a significant difference between the previous classification or description of the job and this one that we have?
I would tell you I'm not exactly sure of that. I probably have to look at Maria, but that would normally be Michael who would answer that, and he is not here this evening. So I apologize.
You can see the old and the new on the as attachments on the item. It didn't seem like it was out of line to me when I was looking at it, but
when I reviewed it, I felt like it was in line. It wasn't that different, but it was enough to modernize the okay. job descriptions right. and the classifications.
In which case, I move approval.
Thank you. Appreciate that. We're trying to update these things and really honor our employees.
Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Trustee Everett.
And we will take a roll call vote.
Trustee Roger and Sarah.
Hi.
Trustee Cominger.
Yes.
Trustee Miller.
Yes.
Trustee Haslam.
Hi.
Trustee Abood.
Yes.
Trustee Gallardo.
Yes.
Trustee Everett.
Aye.
Trustee Parker.
Aye. Now we're moving to item 14.1, establishing the appropriation limit for fiscal year 22-23. This is a pro forma annual routine report, and it looks like we are not taking action on it as it's in the report section. Do we need action on this, Dr. Rio?
Actually, it should be in as action. Yeah, you want to speak to this, why it's not listed as action? Because it does say reports information.
Good evening, board members. It should be an action item. There's actually a resolution that's required to go with it. We are not under a time crunch. We do not need to do it at this board meeting if we want to push it off till the September board meeting.
Yep, let's do it at our September 15th meeting.
Yeah. I would recommend that.
That moves us to item 14.2, International Programs Annual Board Report. I'm popping over here. All right.
Good evening, President Parker, Dr. Murillo, and members of the board. And thank you for the opportunity to provide a brief update on our international programs. Let me try to figure out this clicker here. For those of you who are less familiar with the program, I included a brief timeline. And Santa Barbara City College, as you can see from this timeline, has had a long and proud history of promoting international education. We started welcoming international students to our campus in the 1950s, offered our first summer study abroad program in 1973, followed by our first semester program in 1982. And throughout the years, we have received a number of recognitions, both from the State Chancellor's Office in 1999, where we received honorable mention for the Exemplary Program Award, as well as more recently in 2019, when we were selected as a finalist for the Senator Paul Simon Comprehensive Internationalization Award. There's a little delay here with this.
Next slide, please. Here, a brief over. Now the mic seems to be on.
Is it on?
No.
We will hold just a moment while that gets working again.
Is it working again?
No.
Thank you.
Was it me? Check. It's fine. I can board it. Thank you so much. So here, a very brief look at our org chart. Since 2020, we lost three permanent classified positions within our program, two international student advisor positions, as well as our international outreach and admissions coordinator. We are in the process of filling one of the advisor positions, and that position was actually on today's board agenda for approval. Here a brief look at our international students by residency. So as you can see on this heat map, this is for spring 22, the majority of our international students came from Asia,
South America and Europe. And the next slide has a little bit more detailed information on where our students are coming from. You can see that 18% came from China for spring 22, as well as another 18% from Sweden, followed by Germany. And then it goes down to smaller percentages for Japan, France, Italy, et cetera. When we look actually at our applications, we can see that this is our application distribution for fall 22, we can see that we get a lot more applications from different nationalities. So we have a more diverse application pool than our pool of actually enrolled students. And there are a number of reasons for that. And one of them is that there are still countries that are having a hard time getting visas. We still have delays at embassies due to the pandemic and different reasons. We also see an interesting trend with our Chinese students. So for the fall, we received about 10% of our applications came from China, which is a significant decrease as compared to previous years. At the same time, we have seen increases from Bangladesh and from India, which used to be in the past entirely focused on graduate programs. And then also Germany, we have seen a notable increase, and that is due to changes in the German financial aid awards, which now include support for students who study at US community colleges. So here, a look at our international students by ethnicity. There we basically see the same trend. The brown bar is reflects our Asian students. So you can see a significant decline there. In comparison, our Hispanic students and our Black student populations have remained more stable. And here, look at our enrollments by major. So our largest major is business administration, followed by computer science. And then it is film and media arts, marketing, psychology. The liberal arts, the 11% that you see there, that really reflects our students who come for a gap year and they choose a liberal arts major because they like to combine classes from different subject areas. And here, a quick look at our headcount. So we can see significant declines here since 2016. The decline in 2017 was actually an intentional reduction in the number of international students. And that was in response to community concerns that our program was growing too large. And then the following years were primarily, the decline was primarily a result of the restrictions implemented by the former Trump administration. So there were visa restrictions that were implemented and the environment was a lot less friendly towards international education. And then of course the 2020-21 decline, as we all know, was a result of the pandemic. Beginning with fall 21, we have seen enrollment increases again. Specifically for our fall applications, we received 540 applications for the fall alone, and that is about the same level we were at in 2018. So there is definitely a rebounding interest there. This is a quick snapshot of who the leading associate institutions are nationwide enrolling international students. And you can see that 4 out of the 8 or 9 colleges here are community colleges in California. California continues to be the number one enrolling state for international students. In Santa Monica, for instance, now, or as of 21, enrolled 2,100 students. That was down from about 3,500 prior to the pandemic. So all of the enrollments have been significantly impacted. And here, sorry for the small font, but I thought it was interesting to take a look at where the students are coming from within the state of California. So statewide, about 45% of the students come from China. So actually our populations are a little bit more diverse than that. And then also, not surprisingly, if you look at the leading institutions, USC continues to be the number one, and then followed by a number of our UCs. Here is a very simplified look at our budget and revenue projections. And so what this is based on is basically on an enrollment projection for this coming year. We anticipate to enroll about 600 international students. And then in the following couple of years, we anticipate enrollment increases of about 200 students per year. And after that, we don't project any additional increases because we want to stabilize the enrollments and not grow to a point where we have grown in the past, where it becomes too much or out of proportion. I should mention that these that the net revenues do not include instructional costs, and that is because instructional costs are very challenging to accurately predict. That may be a study that might happen later on. But so this is only looking at the international enrollment fees and then offsetting the expenditures for the program budget. This is this year's budget in a nutshell. So we have about $660,000 allocated to salaries and benefits, then supplies, materials, then travel and conference. And then our agency referral fees that are proportionate to the number of students we attract, and then advertising and marketing. And we allocated $10,000 for campus events because we are anticipating to do more on campus cultural activities and social activities, which I think will really benefit our international students, because we've heard, of course, in prior meetings that that is what students are looking for. Here, a quick look at our revenues for the past 3 years. So we can see that the revenues, of course, reflected the significant enrollment decreases. The gray bars that you see here reflect the HERF funding that was used to offset our international revenue losses. So that's why the bars are higher than what they normally would have been without that. And then the next slide is a quick look at what we are projecting based on the enrollments that I previously mentioned there. So by 24-25, we will actually be a little bit higher at where we were in 2018 in our projected revenues. Sorry for this delay. This thing is very slow. Here we go. I thought it would be interesting to include the numbers for our congressional district. So in District 24, international students contributed $236 million to the local economy, and Santa Barbara City College students alone contributed about $9.2 million, supporting 48 jobs. And you can see that, not surprisingly, UC Santa Barbara is the largest enrolling institution. And when we look ahead, we have some things that are actually very positive, and that is a very strong interest in our program. So the application counts have gone up significantly. Also, in talking to our marketing partners, we know that there is strong interest again among international students to study abroad. We still have a very solid reputation as one of the leading programs among community colleges. And as I mentioned briefly before, we are seeing a diversification of our applicant pool, which I think will be great. And then the challenges are, we have a historically high dollar. It's at the same level as the euro, which it has never been since the euro was implemented. Also increased competition, not only from within the US, but worldwide, because everybody is trying to regrow their international enrollments. And then I think what is not unique to Santa Barbara, but definitely unique to the state of California, is the housing shortage. Here, just a few testimonials. It's always great to hear the students' comments. And despite all the challenges that we have had throughout the last years, generally speaking, the students really, it's wonderful to see how much they value their experience here at the college, how they love the professors and the services that they receive. And at this point, I'm just going to do a very brief update on our study abroad programs. So as you know, because of the pandemic, we had to basically postpone our programs from summer 20 till fall 21. During that year, we did a lot of research on what would be, and kind of to develop a rubric on when we feel it is safe to go again. We did a lot of, we talked to a lot of colleagues at the UC Education Abroad and other community colleges. And we also worked with our service providers to come up with risk assessment and emergency contingency plans. So in 22, spring of 22, we had our first program again in Italy. It was very successful despite a small COVID outbreak. We activated our plan and it worked really well. Students were safe. We had provisions for quarantining, etc. So I feel confident that we are able to move forward with our programs in a safe way. And then we had a great program, very successful this summer in Germany and the Netherlands, led by Rayanne Napoleon and Stephanie Dotson. And for the coming year, we'll be going to Italy, to France, to Bali, to Japan and Costa Rica. So lots of exciting options coming up. And here again, just the leading institutions, we're among the, this is within California, we're there within the top eight, but these numbers, of course, are COVID numbers. Normally our enrollments would be about three times as high per year. And I also wanted to briefly highlight that last year, SBCC was recognized by the US State Department as a 20-year top producer of Gilman scholars in the associate colleges category. And I think that is a really great achievement because the Gilman scholarship is a scholarship that provides funding for racially minoritized students and for traditionally underrepresented students in study abroad. So I'm really proud of our efforts to make study abroad affordable and accessible to our typically underserved students. And then earlier last month, we were invited to present at the Ideas Conference, which was also co-sponsored by the Department of State. And very briefly, our goals, we want to reach our pre-pandemic numbers in terms of enrollments. We need to actively recruit new faculty to maintain the long-term viability of the program. We need to prioritize low-cost programs and also continue to diversify our programs. And of course, continue to ensure that our students have equitable access for traditionally underserved students. And again, I will just close with a few testimonials that you can't read here, but I know you received this report in advance. And so thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you so much. I believe we do have public comment on this item. So if we could go ahead and pull in one of our attendees, Dr. Charlotte Moore, into the panel.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Hi, thank you. I actually wanted to make a public comment for item 12.2. I don't know if I put my hand up at the wrong time, but I was waiting to give a comment in regards to that item. Is it too late to do so?
No, you're always welcome to.
Okay, thank you. So I'll be brief. In regards to the LOMAS training, the terms racial equity and anti-racism have finally become the common and overdue language needed for discussion and mitigation. As a content expert for addressing racism in nursing, I support the implementation of this resource. Hopefully this training will reflect the long history of systemic racism that associated barriers and improve the faculty's awareness to become and remain competent with the skill set to equitably educate our students. Lastly, I believe that SBCC should continue this resource to foster an environment among the staff, faculty, and students an intolerance to racism, anti-Blackness, and various forms of discrimination. And that's in statement. And again, apologies for not raising my hand at the appropriate time. My name is Charlotte Gullett Moore, and I am an educator at the California State University and also content expert with a national nursing organization, Commission of Addressing Racism in Nursing. And thank you.
Thank you so much. And I believe also a candidate in Trustee Area 1, if I am not mistaken. Let us circle back to study abroad. Do I have any and international students? Do I have any questions?
I just wanted to compliment you on the great report as always. And I actually, I don't know if I said this at the last board meeting, but I met somebody in the community recently who was just giving so many compliments on international students who worked for them, who went to SBCC. So that we do have a real impact in helping the area beyond the students we educate. They do go out into the community and make a difference. So thank you for the work you're doing. And
thank you so much for sharing that. And thank you to both of our international students here who I think are contributing a lot. Yeah.
Any other comments or questions? Yes, Dr.
The same comment, but for the study abroad program. Having been a participant of that process many times, I'm aware that the students benefit enormously, but so do the faculty. The faculty who goes on one of these study abroad programs comes back enriched and enlivened and refreshed. And at least in my teaching, in my teaching experience, I found that was so valuable. My only point of criticism is there's nobody going back to China or Vietnam. And how can we help inspire that?
Yes, I know. You and I have talked about that. I think that this, at the moment, it is even more challenging just because China has been so restrictive with COVID. So I think as we are looking at a more normalized situation, that may become easier. But I think for the last few years, that was definitely a factor. Yeah. But I will continue to try. Yes.
Good.
Trustee Everett.
I don't have a question, but I do have a comment. I thought the presentation was just really wonderful. And I did blow up the screen and read some of the students' testimonials, and they were really, quite lovely. I just wanted to say that I'm so grateful for the attention to equity and affordability for underrepresented students to get this experience, because I do think that it redounds not only to the students individually, but to the campus and as well as the community at large, because they come back with a better perspective on the world. So I really appreciate that. And I'm just so excited to see that it's a priority.
Thank you so much, Dr. Everett. And I want to add to that we actually do targeted outreach to our EOPS students, our transition students. And the Gilman Scholarship is so important because it provides students with $5,000 for the program, which is almost the entire program cost in many cases. So thank you.
The only thing that I would add here is I don't know if we are unusual as an institution, but to see the way our international students take on leadership roles here has just been it's amazing. So they're key to actually running the school. And so I really am so appreciative of that and so mindful of that. And I hope that continues. I have a suspicion that it's probably unusual. And I think that it's fantastic. So thank you again. And I hope that your estimates are correct in terms of enrollment. That would be wonderful. So I hope that that's the direction that we go in. So thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Okay, that brings us to item 15.1. This is our monthly resolution authorizing teleconferencing for board meetings pursuant to AB 361. So this is resolution number 2. We have seen this many times at this point. Is there this is a resolution, so we're just going to we do need a motion to approve the resolution. Mm-hmm. So I will,
is so moved.
Moved by Trustee Everett.
Yep.
Seconded by Trustee Hasland, and we will take a roll call on this resolution number 2.
What? Oh yeah, it is a resolution.
Yeah, it's
that every month thing.
Mm-hmm.
Trustee Roger Lindero.
Aye.
Trustee Miller.
Aye.
Aye.
Trustee Cairo.
Yes.
Trustee Crawford.
Aye.
Trustee Adu.
Yes.
Trustee Croninger.
Yes.
Aye.
Thank you, and it passes unanimously. This brings us to item 15.2, report from board members. Do board members have any items to share at this time? Trustee Everett?
Yes, I just wanted to report on the strategic planning that we had in Area 4. While I was disappointed at the turnout generally, I just found that the folks who were there were very engaged. And we had, I think, a productive session. And I was really grateful for all the voices that were heard, including, as I mentioned before, folks who were disagreeing with the vaccination and the masking process. But on the whole, I do think that we have some information, and I just look forward to doing some more outreach for my area.
Thank you.
In person.
Yes.
We also had such a session, long-range planning session or strategic planning session in Area 1 in Carpinteria. And we also had a small turnout, but they were dynamic. They really had strong opinions and very specific opinions. And the one takeaway that I took note of was the fact that the vast majority of those there identified the absence of a center of continuing education in Carpinteria was a serious negative. We have one in Santa Barbara, we have one in Goleta. We need to have one, perhaps not a large one, but just a space that allows us to extend the values of Santa Barbara City College and its educational system to Carpinteria and Summerlin.
Trustee Miller.
We also had a very successful evening or afternoon in Goleta at the Goleta Valley Community Center. We had, it was a good attendance. It wasn't a huge number, but I would not have been surprised if it had been it would have been fewer than we had. So I was very pleased with it. I know we filled up the whiteboards with stickies, with ideas, and there were lots of interesting ideas. But I'd just like to add that I think the whole process has been very successful. Even for those people who did not join us, they know that we're reaching out. And I think that is probably equally as important as the actual people who showed up at the events. So job well done.
Thank you.
Yes. So I went to the Community College League of California student trustee training, and I gained a lot of knowledge in relation to my position. So I'm really grateful that I went there. Concerning the vaccine mandate, so what we want at SBCC is to protect our students and to reduce the spread of the virus, of course, and that's why we have the vaccine mandate. But so yeah, some students feel safe coming on campus thanks to it. I know a lot of students who feel safe thanks to it, but some of them don't. They are against it, as we all know, and that's because their education is compromised. They are struggling online. They want to be able to go in person. Even also for the tutoring sessions, it's easier in person to be able to have access to resources such as the food pantry, because we can have free food, but unvaccinated students can't go into the food pantry because they can't go inside of buildings. So we have so many great resources at SBCC, and unfortunately, lots of students can't benefit from it, and that is not equitable. But what is really difficult about that whole situation is that some students are against it, but some students feel safe too. So I just want to thank Dr. Murillo for sharing that our survey is going to be sent. And I think that it is great. And I hope that it will bring good data that will help the Board of Trustees as we are moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Student Trustee Rajosarath. I think that's really helpful to hear. Any other board reports? Yes, Trustee Abboud.
I'll mention that I applied for the Community College League Legislative Committee last week. So hoping to hear back soon on that further, yeah.
Thank you. And Trustee Croninger?
And I was just going to follow up that we had a strategic planning meeting as well in Santa Barbara. And again, it wasn't a huge turnout, but the people who were there really were engaged and they cared and they had great ideas. So.
All right. Well, I'm going to look to those of you sitting next to me to kind of help me with the one thing that I want to say, which is that I know that we have an election coming up in November. There are four trustee area seats that are up for election. Trustee Haslund and I are not running again. And so we will be stepping off the board after the November meeting. So for trustee area seven, that there was one candidate that filed, Ellen Stoddard, who I think many of you who have worked here at SBCC for a long time will know her. So she will be stepping onto the board in December for trustee area seven. For trustee area one, I believe two people filed. Is that correct, Trustee Haslund?
That is correct.
And do you have their names?
I do. The first candidate is one who spoke to us a little while ago. Her name is Charlotte Moore. She's a registered nurse, a nurse practitioner, and she is an educator at Cal State Channel Islands in the field of nursing. The second candidate is Debbie Stoker, who I don't know a lot about. I've met her several times. She's a delightful person. And
all right,
we will see.
Thank you. And then Trustee Abboud, I believe you are running again and that there was only one person that filed in your seat. So you will be stepping back into your seat automatically in December. And then Trustee Croninger, you filed for trustee area. Which area are you? Area four, five. Okay, trustee area five.
Correct.
And did you have an opponent?
Yes, and I was just trying to check her name. And my problem is that there's a long list of people who are on the ballot and I'm not landing on the right place, but it's a little bit difficult for me to know exactly how to pronounce it.
Uh-huh.
But I believe it's Sharon Jakota or similar to that.
Okay. All right, so you will have a race. We will have two races in general for SBCC. And two people that will be stepping automatically in December. So best of luck to those who are in races and thank you to those of you who have stepped forward to serve and will be sworn in December.
And you and I will be sitting out there watching.
Clapping for them, yes.
And I just wanna say, it's gonna be such a shame to not have you two here as signposts for stability and just well-reasoned judgment. So thank you so much for your service and I'm really gonna miss you both.
We're not gone yet.
I'm just getting my, my little acknowledgments in early.
There you go.
Practicing.
Okay, we are now to item 16, items for future board consideration. Are there any items that board members, Wait, I'm forgetting to look and see that Trustee Gallardo is ready to share. Trustee Gallardo, please jump in.
No problem. My first question was with the feedback. Kendra, do you know when we'll get the results for the folks that had the option to submit online that didn't attend a face-to-face?
I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand the question.
Oh, online there was a link available for the public to also submit their feedback that didn't attend.
Oh yes, we plan on definitely all. So it would be online students, face-to-face students. We believe we should survey all of our students and all of our faculty and staff.
Oh yeah, no, the link's already available. I'm wondering when we'll get that, the results.
I would like to try to have them to you at the September 15th meeting, which means we'll have to survey, and this might be hard if we survey the first week of school. So, but we might be able to do it. We're concerned that we may not get, yeah. Oh, I'm sorry. I apologize. I can't hear really well. So the strategic plan survey. Oh, we actually may have some of those results at your retreat on Saturday. Oh. Thank you, Martha. So we won't have them all, but we may have some.
Okay.
So we actually had 161 the last time I was told. And Z, I'll just ask you if we've had an update.
We haven't had an update yet on the new numbers, but yeah. We're going to keep it open until the 21st because there's a few more activities happening next week, but we'll present the preliminary results this Saturday at the board retreat.
Awesome. Thank you. And then I also am going to miss Peter. I know you're not physically there, but anyway, I know where we can hang out because I have been invited to your home, and I think that's amazing. And you are also in town, Kate, so that will be good. And then I did get to learn about Miss Debbie Stoker, and I believe her connections are as a parent of SBCC alumni, so deep connections with the college. And then what I know about Miss Sharon Denise Jagodka, or Denise Salvador Jagodka, is also longtime third generation, I think, Santa Barbara High Roosevelt parent, and also City College alumni. So both candidates, I think we all have, there's a lot of great options. And I think that people stepping up, I think a lot of it is attributed to the resolution that we passed that Marcia really spearheaded, where we as a board agreed that we wanted democracy to work, and we wanted to encourage as many people to step up and serve in this capacity. So I think that's awesome. So I think that it'll be a good thing for everyone.
I appreciate that. And I just want to follow up since, she's referring to the resolution limiting funding, limiting fundraising for this when you run for election for the SBCC board. Mm. And, you know, I do want to thank you, Trustee Croninger, because I think that was an important resolution to pass. And I'm hoping that our candidates are abiding by it. Trustee Everett?
Yes, I just wanted to acknowledge Martha and Z and the hard work they did on the strategic planning meetings. And, you know, thank you so much for being there. It's great.
All right. Items for future board consideration. Anything to bring up at this time? Yes, Trustee Croninger.
I'm sure it's on your radar already, Dr. Murillo, but I'm interested when we get a chance to look at the data, to get disaggregated data on our students who sign up for fall.
Okay, thank you.
You know, and I realize that's we're still signing up, so it's not immediate. I'm just sort of looking ahead.
Thank you. And I was going to ask Z and Maria to make sure that we have an enrollment report for September so that we can see who signed up, and we'll disaggregate it.
All right, with that, I'm going to move us to 17. We do not need to reconvene to close session. So that brings us to item 18.1. And if there's no objection from my fellow board members at this time, I am going to adjourn our meeting. We will be meeting again Saturday, 2 days. So looking forward to our in-person board retreat here on campus outside. And until the long hours, till we see each other again, hang in there. Thank you. Meeting is adjourned.